Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 14th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are this week conducting in a hybrid format. We have received apologies from Monica Lennon, MSP. At agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 is consideration of evidence heard this morning. And item 5 is consideration of the committee's approach to an inquiry on ferry services. Do we agree to take these items in private? Thank you. That is agreed. Items 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Agenda item 2 is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. We launched the inquiry in December to look into progress at local government level in achieving national net zero targets. The inquiry is also considering what role the Scottish Government and its agencies can play in supporting local government in delivering those national net zero targets. We are now in phase 2 of the inquiry, which means we're looking in depth at some of the key themes that have emerged so far during the inquiry. And today we turn to transport. We will hear from a panel of experts on the role of local authorities in helping decarbonise transport in Scotland. And I'm pleased to welcome our panellists this morning who are joining us remotely. We have Steve Gooding, Director, RAC Foundation, Ewan Wallace, Chair, Society of Chief Officers of Transportation of Scotland, and Paul White, Director, Confederation of Passenger Transport Scotland. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for taking time out and joining the committee. We very much appreciate it. We've got around 70 minutes for this panel, and I believe there are no opening statements, so we will move straight to questions, and I will begin. The first question I have relates to electric vehicles in Scotland. The number of public charging points for electric vehicles is currently around 2,200. The consensus seems to be that Scotland will need to have around 30,000 public charging points by 2030 to support the expected increase in electric vehicles. Earlier this year, the Scottish Government announced that it will provide up to £60 million to local authorities over the next 4 years to support the rollout of public charging points for electric vehicles. A couple of questions in this area. Is the 30,000 target by 2030 realistic, and what needs to happen for this target to be reached? And is this enough funding from the Scottish Government, the £60 million announced earlier this year? And do local authorities have the necessary resources, capacity and expertise to implement these plans? I appreciate quite a few questions there, but it would be helpful to have that wide-ranging discussion to kick things off. And maybe in terms of directing the question, I could start with Steve, then move to Ewan, and finally Paul. So Steve, over to you, please.
Thank you very much. I really rather feel slightly embarrassed at starting off by saying, in answer to your questions there, we can't really be absolutely sure. It depends. And the reason I say that is for a variety of factors relating to the charging of electric cars, starting with one pretty basic one, which is when we talk about the number of chargers, it's very easy to get fixated on, we need, is it 20,000, is it 30,000? We need to ask ourselves what sort of chargers we're talking about. The important thing here is there's a world of difference, both in terms of performance and in terms of the commercial position between, for example, relatively low speed chargers. We've heard a lot about converting lampposts, for example, to be chargers for vehicles that are parked overnight, and rapid chargers that might be fitted in specific rapid charging hubs that look perhaps remarkably like service stations as we think of them today. We almost certainly need a mix of those in the future. And one of the reasons it's so important to have local authorities involved in this debate is because local authorities are best placed to understand for any particular location the likelihood of properties, domestic properties and business properties, to have off-street parking where charging can be provided. Our view is that the people who are most likely to go into electric vehicles soonest are those for whom, unsurprisingly, it's the most convenient and also it makes sense economically. And if you have off-street parking at home, if that's in a position where you can have a home charger, then chances are going electric is going to be a good bet for you, because charging an electric vehicle and running it is good value for money, certainly at, even at current electricity prices, in compared with using traditional fossil fuels. But I would also add, one of the key things members of this committee will know extremely well is that any policy like this, when we're talking about numbers, we've got to think about locations and the very different types of locations we're talking about in Scotland. And if I draw a very crude comparison between the central belt and perhaps the more rural and remote areas, one of the things we found here at the RSC Foundation in a report we published a couple of years ago now, where one of my colleagues drove the North Coast 500, a very attractive route, in his electric car, pure electric all the way around, was that Scotland is perhaps ahead of the rest of the country in the installation of chargers and in the ease of their use. One of the things we found quite surprising to us was actually an electric car can be a great option if you're living in a rural area where you can have charging at home. But there is a big issue ongoing about the reliability of the chargers that are installed. So it's undoubtedly the case we're going to need more. We're going to need a mix of slow and fast, rapid chargers, rapid chargers in hubs that are convenient for people, encouragement for people who can have electric vehicles at home and charge them at home to do so, and perhaps to encourage them, particularly in rural areas, where actually going electric can be more convenient and more cost-effective than sticking with fossil fuels.
Many thanks for that answer, Steve, particularly the insight into the kind of one-size-fits-all idea, and the idea that it's not just a numbers game, that it's about the type of charging points. That was very helpful. I'm sure my colleagues will want to come in on some of those issues. Let me address the same question to Ewan Wallace, please.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, good morning, members. So, yeah, absolutely. Steve's nailed a number of the points I would have certainly picked up on in terms of the points you've asked about. We look closely at the 30,000 number in terms of, you know, looking at how that fits in terms of, you know, the public locations, the numbers that are going to be divided by individuals, as Steve said, on in terms of driveways and outside their properties. And then also the role that businesses play in terms of the locations where vehicles will ultimately access energy, and that's how we would, you know, break it down. It's, you know, when Scots have looked at this, we're considered it in the same terms as, well, how does a vehicle currently access, you know, petrol and diesel, for example. So, you know, how many locations would there be that you can actually get to those, be able to refuel and recharge your vehicle, and look at it in that, in a very similar manner. With obviously, it's far easier to be able to recharge a vehicle than outside your home than it is to be able to go and refuel it in terms of petrol and diesel. I think we've got some really good examples of looking at the practicalities of delivering within, particularly some of our urban settings. So our colleagues in Dundee City Council are probably one of the leading councils in Scotland in terms of what they've achieved through good strong policies, you know, strong leadership, I think, at political and certainly officer level, and they've driven that forward really, really positively in terms of what they've managed to put in, and with good support from the private sector as well. So, you know, companies that have seen the opportunity in terms of the reduced costs of operating the vehicle fleets that they have, and therefore they are certainly one of the leading lights in terms of a Scottish context. 60 million over that same period, substantial amount of money. With awareness, authorities are working closely now with Scottish Futures Trust in terms of the administration of that funding. There are 14 pathfinders that have been taken forward already. And as a society, we're Scottish Futures Trust are now engaging directly with ourselves and COSLA about the practicalities. So it's a two-way thing here in terms of, you know, we're going to be able to bring into that discussion what does it actually mean to put in that level of infrastructure within potentially a public streetscape, and what's the knock-on implications. A number of authorities across Scotland are already developing policy positions about on-street provision, because there are concerns about how that, what you could actually land up with in terms of the sheer volume of on-street charging locations. Is that the correct way to go? Does that perhaps go against other policy areas where we're wanting to actually probably reduce the amount of of kit within the streetscape to make it more attractive for cycling and walking, for instance. So we're working through that in some detail at the moment, convener, and you, in doing so, we'll be able to bring that back into and share that across all 32 local authorities, 7 regional transport partnerships. And the final point you were asking about was the wider resource. I think that's possibly our experiences have been across Scotland are a little bit varied in that, but the one common thing is that the reliability of the kit at the moment is not what it should have been. So, as Steve said, and getting access to the right people to make sure you keep that the facilities up and running. Now, one of the things we've looked at is it actually easier when you have a large scale location? You know, and as Steve said, you know, equivalent to essentially a refueling station. So you're able to keep that ticking over. If you're going to choose to go and recharge your vehicle at that location, you have greater certainty that at least one of the charge points is going to be available. If you're driving to Lairg, for example, and there are only 2 points available, and they're both you know, one's not working and the other one's already got a vehicle in it, that's where the range anxiety and the concerns start to kick in. So we're working hard on sharing all that knowledge and making sure that we're feeding that back into national agencies and then also sharing that across all our partners. And I'm conscious I haven't answered your question in terms of is 30,000 realistic? I would go with Steve. I genuinely don't know right at this stage, but if you were to ask us that within the next, you know, in 12 or 18 months' time, we'll have a much better feel for how deliverable that number is. So, thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Ewan. Yeah, you brought out a number of points there. Good to get that practical perspective as well. And Paul, if I could address the same question to you, please.
Thanks, Chair. I can't really speak to car charging and a number of electric cars that you might see, but in terms of bus and coach, I think a number of our points mirror a lot of Steve's points. It's about types of charger. We have within the bus and coach fleet a number of which will be electric vehicles, but some for longer distances that might be hydrogen. Are we taking that into consideration? In terms of car charging, as Ewan says, a concern for us would might be taking in on-street provision and on-street car parking or charging that might impact upon other local authority policies around a switch to sustainable and active transport and providing, for example, bus lanes or cycle lanes, and that being a concern. I think with our conversations with the likes of Scottish Future Trust and the distribution network operators, the energy suppliers, worth bearing in mind the timescales for this type of activity as well that need to be considered. The DNOs have plans that stretch years into the future. So, consideration of new sites for charging, be that car or bus. These conversations need to start now if you want to see that progress in the next 3 years. So some big challenges ahead for car and for bus in terms of providing the infrastructure for charging. For hydrogen coach, for example, which hydrogen is probably the fuel that most will be attracted to for longer distance journeys. If we don't have the hydrogen charging infrastructure there, then you're essentially that location is no longer accessible by coach, so it's something worth considering.
Great, thanks very much, Paul, and thank you. Those opening remarks set the scene very well. In fact, I think Mark Ruskell has a supplemental in this area. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. It was just when you were talking there, Ewan, just about the charging infrastructure. I wanted to ask you and Steve just about the consistency of rollout of charging infrastructure around the country, because you know, my experience is you can go to one area like Stirling or Dundee and it's excellent. You go to Edinburgh and it's very poor, and that can kind of build in the range anxiety. So what do you see as the sort of progress that can be made in terms of having consistent EV infrastructure rollout? Because at the moment we still seem to be in a phase where it's being led by local authorities that have got a particular interest and have perhaps gone for the pathfinder funding and are forging ahead. I'll maybe just put that to you, because it's a local authority question primarily.
Thank you very much, Mark, for in terms of, yeah, that's at the core of where we are, I think, across the 32 authorities plus the 7 RTPs. and just get, if you, when we map across them, we see the ones who have taken that early strategic decision that they're looking to access the funding that's been made available from Scottish Government, but also put in their own capital funding as well, where it's deemed appropriate. I think in terms of the consistency we're going to get, the pathfinders will definitely help. And I say we're literally, over the last couple of months, having really good, positive, detailed discussions with Scottish Futures Trust, because I know that they've overseen it and they want to make sure that we start to get that level of consistency. And you know, I'm in terms of the learning that's going on already. So certainly we've had detailed sessions involving local authority engineers, particularly from those authorities who haven't necessarily been at the forefront of putting in the infrastructure, who are learning now from the others. So that's literally happening right at the right now. There's a complicated mapping exercise of what the current provision is, and in different locations, and that's going to, that's being shared out across authorities. That then still requires a decision to be able to mobilise people to go and do that. But that's where the seed funding of the 60 million and able to access that means that an authority that is struggling will have a number of options. They can then go back to the Scottish Futures Trust to say we're going to need more help on this, to develop a programme of activity over the next 12, 18, 24 months. Potentially, that might involve going to the market. It might involve going to one of the other local authorities who have already developed that expertise, and that's happened in other sectors, in terms of within the experience of Scots. So that's not unusual either. So you will get that help across boundaries, because the one thing I would say is that there's a recognition of the importance of the wider issue around move to net zero and tackling climate change across all of the Scots membership, and perhaps actually the EV one is one of the earliest ones, and there's a tangible thing there where, because that's within the fabric of the road network, it becomes very, very real very quickly. So it impacts on individuals, it impacts within a community, and it's something that then comes through the post boxes of individual elected members and at ward level. So it becomes very, very real very, very quickly, but it becomes positive very quickly when you're actually able to make sure that you put something in the local town centre car park that is then available. And it has the double, it has the additional thing whereby, is that the better place to put some that type of infrastructure? Because it takes people who have chosen to use a private car to access a town centre, but they know they can then recharge the vehicle and they can go about their business in that area. It's just joining up all those different bits, and that's something we, as a society, we do quite a lot, try and do a lot of, and it's one that each 6, 12, 18 months down the line, we're going to be looking closely at what the progress is across all of the different authorities, and if there are ones that are a bit behind, then ourselves, SFT, Scottish Government, and others are there to help to try and. You'll help them along the same path.
Okay, thanks very much. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Liam Kerr also has a supplemental in this area. Liam, please.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Very briefly, Steve Gooding, just to pick up on your comments earlier, it seems to me getting the charges in place is all well and good, but I was reading last week about the CEO from Rivian, who seemed to be warning of a battery and materials shortage. And then I think I was also reading Elon Musk at Tesla saying that the lithium prices are going through the roof. Now, do you recognise that? And if so, is there any projection being done on how that will impact the 30,000 chargers requirement and indeed EV uptake over the next, let's say, 10 years?
Steve, did you hear that question?
Hello? Yes, sorry. Yes, I did. Just waiting for the unmute to come on. Yeah, it's exactly the right question to ask, and it's a very hard one to answer. And the reason for that is that you're right to pick up on the fact that there are some difficulties in the supply chain for the creation of batteries in particular. So batteries require lithium, they require what are called rare earth metals, called rare for a reason. The global supply of those has been affected by some of the very unfortunate things that are happening around the world at the moment. What we really need is a breakthrough in battery technology, and a huge amount of money is being thrown at that, not just in this country, but around the world. Without that breakthrough, without finding different materials from which batteries can be constructed, or indeed different technology in the way that batteries are created, we are going to find ourselves probably running up against constraints in the number of vehicles that are built globally, but are then allocated to the UK market. And we've done some work in the foundation. We've done it in combination with the English Electric Vehicle Energy Task Force to look at the likely availability and then take up of electric vehicles. And all I can really say about that is there's a wide range of future possibilities, which is why it was so hard to answer that 30,000 question that the convener posed in the first place. But I think that the likelihood is we're seeing more and more models coming to market. The auto companies are investing hugely. We've seen Volkswagen putting a lot of money into its own battery manufacturing capability. We're seeing other investment going in this country that's government supported. It doesn't look like the batteries themselves are the constraint at the moment. Actually, the constraint on getting new cars at the moment is a shortage globally of semiconductors and a shortage of wiring looms, which were until very recently a major export from the Ukraine. So there are uncertainties there. But if I may just add one further thought, which harks back to a previous point, and it's that we need to think about the cars. We also need to think about commercial vehicles and not just buses here. So when we're thinking about charge points, we need to be thinking about vans, other vehicles that enable our towns and cities to function, minicabs and taxis if people are to be encouraged out of their private cars and perhaps into different forms of mass transit, perhaps with smaller vehicles, and think about how they're going to be serviced as well. And maybe some of the differences between local authorities in terms of numbers of chargers and locations of chargers comes back to the balance, which I'm sure we're going to be getting onto, between whether it's better to encourage people with cars to switch to electric, or whether it's better to try to encourage people who've got cars now, not to perhaps own their own car, but to use a mix of public transport and maybe join a car club for the occasional longer trip they need to make.
Thank you. That's fascinating. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Liam. Actually, I think Paul White wanted to come in on this question as well. So, Paul, I'll bring you in to address Liam Kerr's question, please.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to really reiterate that point as it stands for the bus sector. We are definitely seeing rarity of certain parts of the manufacturing process impacting upon price. When you're looking at the model for bus funding to allow us to transition to net zero, that it is based upon the cost of the vehicle reducing and the benefits of switching to electric as opposed to paying for diesel. And as we're not seeing that reduction in price of vehicle, and the cost of juicing your vehicle essentially is increasing, so the business case for that accelerated investment to net zero is difficult to stack up because for factors as I've raised about the rarity of certain elements that are required for those vehicles.
Great. Thank you very much, Paul. I had a couple of questions following up on the initial discussions from a local authority perspective. We've heard of the benefits from local authorities having local knowledge, which is going to be vital in this area. I wanted to explore some of the highlights. Mark Ruskell spoke about consistency across local authorities. There are 32 different local authorities in Scotland. Are we likely to see consistent technologies used across local authorities? Is this hardwired into the system, or is there a risk that different technologies may be used with the result of some confusion there? And a kind of related question about economies of scale. Are we seeing local authorities adopting individual procurement policies here, or do we see some pooling of resource and therefore benefiting from economies of scale in procuring what is expensive equipment, I assume. Perhaps I can start with Ewan, and then if Steve and Paul want to come in, please indicate.
Okay, thank you, convener. So the second one first, maybe in terms of the procurement model. So across the local authority side of things, we utilise heavily utilised framework type contracts often administered by Scotland XL. And certainly on the vehicle procurement side of things for our own fleets, that's been in place now for a number of years. I think it might even be in its third iteration in terms of the for the actual bringing in the types of vehicles across our own fleets. And also more recently there's been developmental work in terms of to try and address that issue around the type of kit to be deployed on street or in within car parks, in terms of, because anybody who's utilised an electric vehicle and goes to a location will see there is definitely a variety of types of charger there. And they have changed year on year. And you can see both the size, number of the cables or out of each individual one. So it can vary from place to place. That is also one of the elements that Scottish Futures Trust are working with us on at the moment. To look at that, and there are some parts of Scotland where your joint procurement teams, that is very much on their radar already, to try and make sure that they can negotiate as good a price as possible for bringing the kit into the location and then to get the installation. So it's about securing the kit, the installation process, and then the maintenance. So that's the type of work that's been developed at the moment, again to be shared through both SFT and also in terms of the work of Scotland XL, so that any local authority can tap into that expertise, so they're not having to necessarily reinvent it. I suppose the one other element around that procurement is also going back to one of the earlier points about the maintenance regime and looking after them. So that's part of the procuring as well. So actually, the potential for an operating part to any contract is also the type of thing that would be looked at. So that it's not then falling to potentially a local authority set of officers who perhaps are already looking after other pieces of equipment, maybe the street lighting network, because that's where the schools often sit. Actually, it can be the requirements that would be placed on looking after that type of kit will often mean that it's a specialist contractor that you require to gain access to, and then that's back into that rural versus urban for locations that are at the end of the supply chain and that are further away. That is to build that into the contractual arrangements as well. So there's work going on to try and develop that, and those contracts, for instance, would tend to be updated every two, three. There might be a three-year contract in terms of framework contract that an authority can dip into, and those will be reviewed regularly. The way they tend to operate is that the practitioners feed into an overall group that then feed back their experiences working under that contract, so that you can then improve it the next time around. So I don't know if that addresses those initial points, convener, in terms of just to get that technology better in the future, dealing with the scale and the procurement challenge.
Yeah, very helpful, Ewan. I think Steve wants to come in, but before I bring Steve in, just wanted to clarify a couple of points. You mentioned framework agreements on the procurement side that allows local authorities to hopefully achieve that economy of scale. They sound optional in nature, correct me if I'm wrong, but they sound optional in nature. They're not necessarily hardwired in terms of, local authorities must use these procurement frameworks. In practice, very roughly, what percentage of local local authorities do use those procurement frameworks in order to kind of ensure consistency and achieve economies of scale.
You're correct, Convener. Yes, they're not a must do. They are optional. It will be down to the individual authority to take a policy position as to, you know. So some authorities might say, no, you know what, we're essentially supporting that collaborative approach through through something like Scotland Excel. We are going to go there as our first choice, to see what value that gives us. But there is always the alternative to then undertake a separate procurement exercise, potentially. It might be two or three authorities out with the Scotland Excel model. I'm afraid I don't have any statistics that would give you a feel for just how many are currently utilising them, but we can certainly take that away, Convener, and come back. We can ask around our network to see what the current usage of those framework contracts, both for vehicle procurement and also for the installation of the EV charging infrastructure. So happy to take that away, Convener.
Yeah, that'd be great, Ewan. Very much appreciate that. And I think Steve wanted to come in on some of these issues. Steve.
Yes, I just wanted to pick up then. So you asked about the technologies. I think that it's really important here that we look at this both through the lens of the, if you like, the citizen, the user, the driver, the motorist, whoever's looking after the vehicle, as well as through the lens of the local authority that's trying to secure best value for money for public investment. But from the user perspective, there's definitely a push from national government and in England, I know, to ensure that charge points are as easy to engage with as possible by the user. And that's a mix both of reliability, and we've talked about that a bit before, but also recognising the fact that if I go to fill up my old petrol car, I can go to a service station, I can use my credit card, I don't have to have a particular loyalty card, I don't have to connect with my mobile phone or any of those things. I can just turn up, fill up the tank, pay, and I'm on my way again. That hasn't been the case to date with many of the publicly available charge points. We need a greater consistency in that sense. Whether the actual technology behind the screen, if you like, behind the kit, has to be consistent, well, it has to work consistently is the most important thing. I think one of the challenges, again, that's come up here is that many of us are familiar with what's effectively version one of public chargers, not all of which were designed to be particularly user-friendly, not all of which have turned out to be particularly reliable. Now we're needing investment to replace those with the next generation of chargers, which by and large are better, but also to have a better informed view of where they should go. Many of the chargers that were installed originally, both in Scotland and around the UK, were installed in places where they could be, perhaps in car parks that local authorities themselves owned, rather than necessarily in the places where people who got electric cars are most likely to use them. Part of that thinking that we're just developing, I would say, at the moment, is to think, if you can use a rapid charger to recharge your vehicle in about 20 minutes, why don't we have a think about where people go for about 20 to 30 minutes? One of the places people go is supermarket. So maybe we should be thinking not to have free to use slow chargers as just a side benefit in supermarkets, but maybe supermarket car parks are some of the best locations for rapid chargers looking ahead.
Thank you very much, Stephen. I know in the context of supermarkets, the concept of permitted developments has been quite important in order that to achieve a fast rollout, and maybe we can come back to that point, because I wanted to bring in Fiona Hislop at this stage. Fiona, please.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. I want to ask about local authorities and how they can best support the delivery of integrated public and active travel networks. Do they have a role, and what should the role be in coordinating information flows, ticketing and the development of transport hubs? And I want to come to Ewan Wallace first, and perhaps to bring it to life, Ewan, if you can maybe reflect on what that means for cities, but also what does that mean for semi-rural areas. So, for example, cities, there are challenges as multimodal, but also in terms of semi-rurals, for example, there's a proposal for park and ride on the M8 at Junction, the Heartlands Junction, and also the new junction at Winchborough on the M9. And should that be the role of the local authority, or would you see that as a transport partnership role? So if you could maybe reflect on that. When I come to, then I'll come to Paul, and if you can think about it, the integrated transport hubs from a bus perspective. And then finally, Steve Gooding, if you can reflect particularly around cars and park and ride and what you'd expect. And you could also perhaps bring in the concept of that shared car electric vehicle reference that you made earlier on. So first of all, to you and Wallace, please.
Okay, thank you. A couple of things in there. From one of the strengths we have as a network is the 7 regional transport partnerships and all 32 local authorities. And certainly, that's partnership working for delivering things at that large scale. So certainly the two sites that you refer to, they fall clearly within the remit of national, regional and local in terms of how do you actually deliver those. I have to say, I'm not that familiar as to whether they may or may not be within, for instance, some of the bus partnership fund proposals for those locations. If they are, then that will automatically mean that the local authorities and the regional transport partnerships will already be working on those types of developments. I can talk with my day job hat on that's the case in the northeast of Scotland for those types of large scale passenger transport interchanges that allows people to who go to that central location. Know that there's they can then change on to either from one bus service onto another. If they're able to cycle or walk to the location, then to get onto public transport. I think the design of what have been traditionally seen as park and ride sites has certainly evolved over a number of years, and that's on the back of experiences from local authorities in terms of working with the passenger transport operating companies in their areas, but also the experience at a national and regional level of what's worked and what's, when you look at what have gone in over the last 10 to 15 years and what have been developed, good information, good facilities, confidence in terms of the safe environment that allows people to wait, that allow people to access those. So the design functions are something that every inputs to. Who actually then leads on that? That will vary across Scotland undoubtedly. Funding certainly has come through local authority side of things when they've bid successfully into national funding. I'm trying to think in terms of other than perhaps the bigger regional partnerships such as SPT, the availability of the level of capital funding for creating large-scale integrated hubs that serve within a city region is often reliant on funding coming from national government to actually make those happen. You can be talking £10, £15, £20 million for some of the bigger sites that you'd be bringing forward. So in terms of that absolutely has to be a partnership approach for those types of things. When you then go into maybe a more rural setting, that across our the 32 authorities, there are some authorities who have developed now integrated hubs, interchange opportunities, and they tend they will tend to have smaller amounts of parking, on a key corridor. That allows people to say, well, access a mainline corridor service in terms of bus services. That will typically, again, when those have been brought forward, if the ones I've seen will have the ability to cycle and walk, will have good cycle parking. They are now starting, and there's a couple of locations I can think of that then have EV charge points in as well. So that would be part of the design criteria. And then other facilities. So quite often as local authorities, you say, well, what else, if you've got people gathering that location, what else would you have? So information boards for the local community, local waste collection points, because that's an easy place to go to and from. So you start to look, as a local authority, has that ability to say, well, what else does that community need? And if we're going to use an area of land, then try and put as many of those things in as possible. This is probably a more emerging area at the moment in terms of where you would see those start to pop up. And I know that is one of the areas that's been identified within National Transport Strategy. And you'll start to see those emerging at a strategic level across Scotland on the back of revised regional transport strategies and then into post the elections. I'm sure that will start to then emerge as the types of things that lots of communities will look to develop. I did try to take a couple of notes there in terms of as we went through the different points. I think I've maybe covered most of the elements there.
It's very helpful. Can I maybe then bring in Paul White on the role of local authorities in coordinating information for transport hubs from a bus perspective, what you think they should be doing, what they could do more? Paul.
Certainly. I think they play a key role. I think, again, as maybe Ewan said, there's a partnership approach to be had there. We're big advocates of integrated transport hubs. The sector it's strongly advocated for them within our evidence to the NPF2 inquiry. I think the things I would note is that through the bus partnership fund, the £500 million that has been allocated to fund bus service improvements through speed up buses and generally improve bus running times. Through that you can form a bus service improvement partnerships where the local authority and the bus operators come together and look at a whole range of local service improvements. And that, although bus features heavily in the terms there, the idea is that the view would be holistic. You would encourage active travel. You would include walking and cycling within your grander vision for the local authority. So within that, you may look for the operator to invest in new vehicles, but between you both, you can look at how you deliver integrated travel, how you look at how you provide information. There's some good work already ongoing with Travelline Scotland, which will expand that valuable resource to include further information and fares, levels, and availability where you can buy those tickets. There's also good work in Glasgow where operators are directly looking at tapping the cap and go. So you've got a capped level of payment per day model that you have already in London. So those are things that are ongoing that you can really look to deliver in partnership. And I think that for us, the Bus Service Improvement Partnership is the best model where you can consider those things to provide that holistic approach. So you can access bus, but there's also, as you say, there's parking, safe parking for bike. There's walking routes to get there. The local authority with its role can really look to where those can be sited and have a strategic approach that delivers bus improvement alongside walking and cycling, so that you're really looking at those top tiers of the sustainable transport hierarchy and delivering for bus users as well as cyclists, walkers and wheelers at the same time.
Thank you. And can I bring in Steve, if we can talk about the car perspective on that integrated transport hub question?
Certainly. So I think it is very important. I think that actually I'd go a step further. I'd say that the local authority's role is not just about putting all of the different aspects of transport onto the page at one time and thinking about them, but actually taking a step back from that, because as we all know, transport's a derived demand. And really what local authorities' job here is it's about making sure we can get access to employment and education and services, and indeed, to some extent, having those things come to us increasingly these days, as we've learned through the severe challenges of the last couple of years of COVID. A lot of us have found that we can get things delivered to our homes and we can work from home. And that's had an impact in the last couple of years on the commuter market and on our access to retail. Whether that's going to continue, I think, is something that really does need thinking about. Is that something that, for example, the Scottish Government, the local authorities, actively want to encourage? The idea that people won't be going into their office jobs 9 to 5, 5 days a week, but perhaps are only going in 1, 2, or 3 days. And the reason I stress that is not only is it important for bus services and for rail services, but also it goes to the question of whether you want people to be travelling or whether by turn, as I think another body giving evidence to the committee has suggested, it would be better to spend rather more money on good signal connectivity, so that it makes it easier for people to work from home. This is something that's happened to quite a large extent in France. That plays to the question you posed me, which is about the scope for park and ride and perhaps for car clubs. I think that if people are working in city centres, if they're trying to get city centres, there's often a good case for encouraging them out of their vehicle before they get into the built-up area. That's where park and ride can work really well. It can provide secure parking. It could in future provide secure parking and a charging opportunity. So that's a win-win for people who are driving in. They can park their car, they can get it recharged, and they can get on a convenient and frequent bus service that gets them right into the centre of town, probably taking advantage of a whole host of bus priority measures that Paul will be telling us that we need to have. But we really need to think about whether the volume, the flow, is enough to sustain the service. And that's where the partnership between the local authority and the bus companies comes in, because if it were the case, and I can only postulate an if here, that office workers aren't going to be doing that 9 to 5, 5 days a week thing, the chances of that being an entirely commercial position are getting lower, because it just won't be the patronage on every day of the week. And certainly I've heard a great deal about how people are choosing to work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday rather than Monday and Friday. And you'd still need the service there in order for people to feel confident about it. Car clubs, probably more something for the central belt and the more built up areas because of the need for convenience. Nobody wants to have to walk a long distance from their house in order to get to a vehicle, a shared vehicle, if they're used to having a vehicle that's their own, that's at their own beck and call. They don't have to book it. They don't have to clean it when they've finished using it. If it's anything like the cars in our household, with children, dogs, and goodness knows what, it's full of mud and sweetie wrappers by the time we're finished. And that's certainly not something you want to find in a shared car. But there is some scope there. But I'd close on something I know the committee's been interested in, which is mobility as a service, where again, I've been in touch with people, George Hazel amongst others in Scotland, for quite a while on this, where I think the role of the local authority is actually central, because there has to be a ringmaster pulling together the different service options for transport and making it easier for people to make a choice between them. And currently we tend to have a system where the various modes are in competition with each other. So why on earth would they be telling us, well, actually, cheaper for you if you did this other thing over here? Somebody needs to be doing that and providing information to us as consumers.
Thank you very much. And I want to ask a second question, but I might just direct it to you and Wallace, unless the other two witnesses want to come in and I'll be guided by the convener in time. I want to discuss the current funding arrangements for active travel infrastructure. Public funds are channeled through SUSTRANS. And is that compatible with national and local climate ambitions? And if not, what kind of funding arrangements should be in place? And I suppose it's that kind of coordination of funding and active travel and what a local authority's perspective is in the role of SUSTRANS. So I think I'll just direct that to you and Wallace, please.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Yeah, so in terms of the positive side of things in terms of how we've operated with SUSTRANS over the number of years across the 32 local authorities. We've seen significant amounts of, as you say, funding routed via SUSTRANS. We established a very specific group to work through details with them on a pan-authority basis. Because I think it'd be fair to say in early on the complexities of bidding in and then monitoring the projects and the funding streams were too onerous, I think would be the view of local authorities. We found that quite difficult to do. So, but I think we've got to a much better place in terms of the as the funding comes through with colleagues from Sustrans, the level of bidding, the way in which they're monitored, and the support that is given by the Sustrans core teams into local authorities is in a much better place. Undoubtedly, the preference at local authority level would be for the allocations to be rooted into local authorities, and Causeland ourselves, I think, have been consistent in terms of seeking that. But we, of course, we have seen that as well in terms of the numerous locations where we can access funding in order to develop active travel projects as local authorities has increased substantially over the last 5, 6, 7 years. So that the overall pot is very much bigger as well. That brings its own challenges because that means that there could be one project that could be funded from 3 or 4 different sources. And so that does then place a burden on the project or programme manager for within that individual local authority. And so I suppose that develops their skill set, but we try and get away from that as much as possible. So the preference would be, yes, more directly into the local authority side of things. But I think that there's a healthy professional relationship with right across the piece, because we know that the overall amount of money has gone up, and it's about delivery. And I think it'd be fair to say that delivery over the last 2 years has been really, really difficult, and therefore that's meant that in some cases at the end of the financial year there hasn't been the level of spend that was expected earlier on. But I think everybody realises the position that a lot of the local authorities were having to reallocate people into other activity over the last couple of years. But we're all looking forward to getting back into a better place, I think, Deputy Convener, in terms of how we actually take that forward. So our preference would undoubtedly be that more would come directly. But as it currently stands, we're in a healthy place in terms of working positively with Sustrans, Living Streets, Cycling Scotland, all the parties that are involved in making our streets more attractive for walking and cycling. And if that is a better way of doing it in terms of getting better value for money, so that we're not bidding as often, so that we get longevity of funding, so they're not we can get 2-3 years worth of allocations at one time, then that would be fantastic. I think a big positive that we've seen more recently is that there's a direct allocation into local government now for the maintenance of new and existing active travel infrastructure. So that's really welcome in terms of that going through the joint distribution group between Scottish Government and local government. And that's now starting to feed its way through, because that was often one of the big issues that we found was we've put something nice and shiny and new in, and 2 years down we run into a problem in terms of being able to maintain it and look after it. So, conscious of time.
Thank you. I certainly recognise that from a constituency case point of view. So, a point well made. I'll pass back over to the convener.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Next up, Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you very much for coming along today. My first question, all of you have probably touched on it slightly already, but so just if I could get a bit of a bigger dig down from you, that would be grand. It's to ask you what the role you think local authorities should be playing in delivering the electric vehicle charging infrastructure, because and not just for the public, but has already been touched on, for commercial and public transport. I know in Aberdeen we're going down the hydrogen route, it seems, for buses, but I'd still like to hear what you think the role for the local authority would be in delivering those. If I can maybe go to Steve first, and then Paul, and then Ewan.
Okay, very happy to engage on that one. I think where I'd start is there is definitely a role for the local authorities, as I said earlier on, in thinking, in bringing local knowledge to bear on the appropriate locations for different types of charger, be they for the public, for open public use, or be they for commercial use. I think it's a question for the Scottish Government as to the extent to which it wishes to run national programmes directly out of Act of the Scottish Government, the extent to which it wishes to use its local authorities as delivery agents for those programmes, or the extent to which it wishes to provide some funding, perhaps, but to delegate exactly how that money is spent to the local authorities. Each of those has its merits. I think there are issues we've touched on before about consistency, about the rules that apply, about how easy it is to gain access to things. I think that the biggest conundrum that's faced in the UK nationally is about the extent to which the provision of charges is in the near term, or is ultimately going to be, a commercial service, just like the provision of petrol and diesel is, or the extent to which, because government wishes to pump prime that market, encourage people, build confidence in people who might be going electric, that the charging infrastructure is going to be there, which necessarily means investing in advance of need. And private sector, understandably, is a bit chary of investing in advance of need if it doesn't think it's going to be getting a return in the relatively near future. So that's where I would say, not just local authorities, but that's where the public sector has an important role to play, whether that's, as I've said, central, the Scottish Government, providing money and funneling that through local authorities. I suspect that is the right answer, because I suspect that what we need is that combination of funding and funding certainty over a number of years, and then local knowledge, which picks up where people are, the trips they're actually making, the trips vehicles are actually making, and of course, the trips that government wishes to enable those vehicles to make, which takes us back to that question about park and ride and the like.
Thank you. There's some points in there that I hadn't even actually thought of. Can I go to Paul now, please?
Thank you. I'd say that local authorities definitely have a role in delivering the infrastructure. I think one of the differences that's often cited between bus and train is that we don't own or have any role in the operating track that we use. So whilst a number of operators will have depots that have charging infrastructure in place, that it's their responsibility to operate and install, there will be a number who require access to energy with the depot at the end of a route, or if you're a coach coming in from another place, so you can't always return to the depot. And so in those instances, it's probably very important that the operators and local authorities work together so that we can understand, in terms of the network, the desired network of bus services from both from the local authority and the operator's point of view, where we might need access to charging infrastructure, and the local authority will be able to feed in terms of what is logistically possible. And again, I was taking with Steve's phrase, I've written it down, in investment in advance of needs, which is very important, because we need to have those, the ability to recharge a vehicle in place before we can really look to the operator to make any changes to the to their fleet in terms of replacing fossil fuel vehicles with hydrogen or electric vehicles, because you really need to be able to run those in the manner that you run your current fleet, and you have access to those charging opportunities. So in short, yes, it's a key role in working to develop where we need that, those charging infrastructure positions and what's possible in those terms.
Thank you. And Ewan?
Well, you'd be glad to know I'm not going to disagree with my two colleagues in terms of the role of local authorities in this one. So yeah, the planning and development and looking at where the best locations are, absolutely, we've got route, and because of the different functional areas that all authorities would have. I think one of what I'm seeing from a number of authorities, of course, is that they're looking at their own fleets and looking at what the requirement is for those, because there's a potential then knock-on from that in terms of if you place EV charge points at different locations that can be utilised by vans and, for instance, used by a local authority. And this is one part of, I think, what certainly colleagues in Dundee did very successfully. You can then also develop the publicly accessible elements as well. And so looking carefully at that. And Energy Saving Trust, I think, have worked with a number of authorities across Scotland to look at exactly that, to identify the gaps, look at what could be put in. So starting at that point. But then one of the key ones that's been touched on a couple of times, you know, our own sites that are under our control as local authorities and that role that play, car parks being the obvious one. I think I would reiterate the nervousness that we have around the role of the road as itself, you know, in terms of the road itself and the impact that that could have longer term. I think significant concerns in terms of, you know, we've already, you know, quite rightly, we're seeing the rollout of the R100 programme. You know, that very much goes in terms of that, you know, that super fast broadband going in across Scotland, and, you know, the utilisation of the road network. If we're then saying that we now want to then, you know, overlay on top of that significant amounts of infrastructure for, you know, putting in charge points at virtually every on-street car park space, I think we would see it, say, as a society, we would not be supportive of that as a position to take. I think it needs to be a more planned, possibly a more regulated approach that would be required to make sure that we're not seeing significant amounts, you know, of impact on street level. And I think, you know, Steve Goody made a good point earlier about the role of private businesses in terms of charging opportunities at the workplace for those that are still going there. And absolutely, I think we're all seeing across Scotland already, supermarkets are putting in place, you know, rapid charge locations because they see the commercial opportunity that brings, because it takes people to that location. That's where local authority then has to say, well, in the same way, should we support local business by making sure that we have similar types of facilities within town centres? So you know, identifying those gaps and looking at it. I think that I've got a couple of other quick points in terms of. Already, I think local authorities are working with the bus companies, you know, on where they see that they do need recharge locations that are maybe more difficult for them to deliver, particularly at the end of interurban routes, you know, where journey times are such that they need to be able to recharge. And then the only other one, I suppose, that I would flag was that absolutely it is the bit that's then emerging in the. Is you've made reference to the hydrogen economy, which is very prevalent in terms of the North East. But I think we're seeing that, you know, good examples in Fife as well, colleagues in Highland. So you know, that for larger vehicles in terms of the supporting infrastructure to allow the use of hydrogen as an energy source, well, it's slightly behind where we are with the electric vehicle, but I think that that will also start to develop over the coming period as well. I think that's, yes, we will be key to it all, and I can try and reassure the members of the committee that that will be something that, as a society, we will try and ensure that we share as much knowledge as possible, and it's very much front and central in terms of the activity that we're involved in at the moment.
Thank you. And as I'm still a serving councillor for Aberdeen City Council for another 2 days, I think it is. So I know the good work that's actually gone in that local authority, but it's been good to get an overall look. My next question, I think, would just be Stephen Ewan would probably be best to answer. And it's regarding the on-street electric vehicle charging infrastructure. How do you think it can be delivered without creating the obstacles for folk with mobility issues or sight loss, for example? My own house, outside my own house, has got an extremely large, wide pavement, and there's no way that right now that I could actually get an electric charging point outside my own place, and I don't have a street column beside my house either. So moving forward, how do you guys see that being delivered? If I could go to Steve first and then Ewan, please.
This is quite a challenge. So as with so many of the things we've been talking about this morning, let's not pretend otherwise. This is difficult. I think that the last thing any of us wants to see is electric cables trailing across the footway. We've got enough problems maintaining our footways for people, whether they have sight issues, mobility issues, or whether they're just like me and not terribly fit. So let's not go there. I think it sounds like that in your case, the chances are you're not going to be able to plug in from your house if you haven't got off-street parking that's really convenient. There's a car parked outside, but it's the other side of a wide footway. So chances are, if you're going to go electric, you're going to be reliant on the public charging network, or perhaps a workplace parking option, but the public charging network. That's where the local authority role comes in thinking about the nature of the street where you live, the numbers of people there, the numbers of cars that those people might have, how often they might need to charge, and whether you would find it not just more convenient, but whether in encouraging you to go down that path, you would be happier if, say, some or several of the lampposts down that street were converted so they were providing overnight charging, such that the cable doesn't go across the footway, it goes from the lamppost stand over to the vehicle. Another important local point there, not all lamppost stands are right at the edge of the footway, we need to recognise that too. But whether it be more convenient for you to be having a more rapid charge and recognising something that is key to this future world of electric vehicles, we've got in our mindset that they'll be a bit like petrol cars and we'll go and fill up once a week or once a fortnight. Chances are we won't. Most of the trips that most of us make are really quite short, less than 10 miles, with a modern, one of the latest generation electric cars with a 200-mile range. It could be once a fortnight or longer between the points where the citizen needs to recharge the vehicle, and they might find it the most convenient thing to do that while they're doing something else. So I'll come back to, are we thinking about where people spend their time? Maybe that 20 to 30 minutes isn't going to a new look rapid charging hub where they sit and read a book, buy a cup of coffee while the car is being recharged. For some of us, that might be perfect. For other people, it might be while they're at the supermarket, while they're at the gym. 30 minutes at the gym, come out, and your car's fit to go for another 2 or 3 weeks' time. So it's that sort of creative thinking that we're going to need, and it's starting to come through now. It's not surprising it's taken a bit of time to come through, but I put that together with, for example, the creative thinking that we should have been doing right from the outset about making sure that this is an inclusive policy and doesn't result in people being disadvantaged. Last up, I talked about the convenience and the design of the chargers. They need to be convenient and designed to recognise that not everyone driving a vehicle has the ability to throw the door open, leap out and walk on their two fit legs to go and connect to the charger. And in fact, I know many people who would find just manipulating the hefty charging cable quite a task. That's a design issue for the industry, to come up with chargers that are intuitive and easy to use for all of us. It's something I suspect Paul could talk about in the way we've gone about the design of buses over the years, where so many things have been done to make them more accessible to people who can't step up into the vehicle, who need handrails that are easy to see, easy to grip onto. We need that mindset to come through in the design of our chargers too.
Thank you. Ewan, would you like to add anything?
A couple of things, just in terms of when, as a society, we've been looking at this particular issue. Undoubtedly, the prospect of cables across the freeway is one just authority just wouldn't really be entertaining. But we have seen, you know, some design proposals which involve putting something at the curb line with pop-up charge units. But again, that would involve running a duct then back across the footway towards a property. And I would, you know, pose the question back again: is do we really see the need, in the same way that Steve said, to provide a charge point like that at every single location where a vehicle would be parked? I think I'm trying to remember. There's certainly a couple of London boroughs who are trialling some of that technology. Interestingly, what they're very clear on is that if another vehicle is already parked in that location, because it is a public road. So there's no guarantee you would get to access into that point anyway. So I would very much support what Steve said about, you know, we need to look at the locations before we go down the route of looking to put in lots and lots of locations on the footway. So we could undoubtedly address the issue in terms of those with mobility and sight issues. You could develop something. In Scotland, our street lighting network is different from England in terms of how the electricity is actually metered. So we don't have the same opportunity to tap into the street lighting network. And also, for very good reasons in terms of ensuring the footways as clear as possible, lots of authorities, as they've been renewing their street lighting stock, have tended to put the street lighting column at the back of the footway, so that it's not at the curbside. For absolutely the correct policy position to make it clearer for people to walk. And I think the final point, I think Steve said about range anxiety, the ability of people to know that they've got 300 miles in their tank, whether it be petrol, diesel, electricity, or hydrogen, will lead to it is. I think it's the terminology is grazing. So people will go, the ability to go and pop up, top up every so often, 20 and 30 miles range added, is something that's already been seen. It's something that colleagues in Dundee, the City of Dundee, have seen. And I think that increasingly that's what will tend to happen. The vehicles themselves know where the charge points are, so they will tell the driver, through the technology. So you will be made aware of, if you've got an issue, I'm down to the last 20 miles, the vehicle will be able to identify locations. Some of them might be private, it will also identify the public ones as well. Because ultimately, I suppose, and then in terms of that equity would be my final point, which is, we've never had equity in the current supply of fuel and diesel across large parts of Scotland and the UK. We all know that in terms of there will be different price regimes according to suppliers. So I'm not sure that actually seeking to have the fully equitable position in terms of the charge per unit of electricity that's available through different suppliers. So you might pay less at a supermarket than you would, for example, at something that's run by one of the large energy suppliers. I think where we as a local authority would have to have a look at is what's the acceptable rate to cover our costs if we're providing electricity in a public location, in a public car park. And I think, my experience, authorities are already doing that and sharing their knowledge of that to make sure that essentially it's not a subsidised, not directly subsidised, we cover our costs. Clearly, an authority could decide that they might want to subsidise if it's a rural area and they feel there's no other supplier and nobody else is willing to provide electricity for those that require it for their use on their vehicles. That might be a policy decision that a rural authority might take, in the same way that they would potentially subsidise the provision of public transport. I think that was all the points that I'd want to make. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I've got one more question, if that's okay, Convener.
Very, very small, please.
Very small. It's just to ask if there were any powers or a freedom to act that you think that the local authorities should have that would assist in delivering a net zero transport system. I suppose that's if I ruled the world kind of question, but just something very quick. You, and I'll ask you, since you kind of like brightened up when I asked that question.
I don't know if it was brightened up, thank you. In terms of what additional powers would we potentially require? I think I can recall being asked this at a session at a previous committee. And I think part of the issue for this is that we have lots and lots of powers as local authorities. The thing we possibly need is a little bit more certainty around some of the funding streams as much as anything. That's often the biggest challenge for us, for an authority to be able to say, if we're going to take this, for instance, we go back to the integrated travel hub question earlier on in the session. So those things can take some time to develop, but we don't always have the certainty around the funding streams. So bus partnership fund is good because it's actually over a longer period of time. But ultimately that didn't require, that's established by government. In terms of, I think we have most of the powers we would currently require. It's just how we apply them in a more collaborative way. and just sort of look at, you know, I think that's probably where I would maybe just pause in terms of that. So I think we've got virtually everything we would need. I would just refer back to the earlier point about, in terms of the, once infrastructure starts to go into the public space, there might be some regulation that we might feel that would it's not so much would benefit the rollout of towards net zero, but it would benefit, I think, ourselves as public bodies to make sure that we do land up with unintended consequences.
Thank you very much. And unless Paul and Scott's got anything to add, Convener, I'll hand back to yourselves.
Okay, that's great, Jackie. Thank you very much. We still have three members to come in with questions, so let's turn to Mark Ruskell next, who will be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. So I wanted to take us on to the topic of demand management. You know, we could spend hours on this, but if you wouldn't mind, I'd just like some succinct responses to this question. Where do you see demand management sitting? We've obviously got the Scottish Government's 20% reduction target. We've got net zero as well to meet. Where do you see demand management and different demand management tools sitting at local authority level, and how should they be deployed? And could we start with Paul, actually, and then we'll move on to you and then Steve.
Thanks, Mark. In answer to the previous question, I think I agreed with Ewan on his point around budget. The two things I'd written down was budget and political will, and I think this question probably comes under the second category there, the latter, political will. I think demand management is an important tool. I think I gave evidence before on that 20% reduction in car kilometres, and I mentioned there would have to be sticks to go along with the carrots. Essentially, you need to look to manage demand and consider things like workplace parking levy, have a debate around congestion charging. I think it's local authorities should have those tools in the toolkit for where they're required. They won't be required in all local authorities, but there should be options that should be considered. And it's whether or not there's the political will there to have those difficult conversations. I think we saw some great progress in what I would call sort of small demand management interventions and sort of spaces for people where you devote, you have a look at road space reallocation and devote more to bus or active travel. Whilst there's been some negative headlines, I think they've been hugely beneficial. So yeah, I think the need to introduce such things, if we're serious about net zero, probably overweighs the hopefully short-term negative reaction that these kind of demand management measures can bring.
Okay, thanks very much, Paul. And then Ewan?
So back to the earlier one, in terms of the powers that we already have, there's low emission zones coming in, that will act as within the larger cities. There's an issue there in terms of choice, in terms of the decision making. You know, that's what demand management is all about, in terms of making that choice clear. What's the impact of that choice you're going to take in terms of the type of mode you're going to utilise? In terms of we already have, as authorities, the ability to vary our own parking charges. We're seeing now the opportunity for the use of workplace parking levies, so that's another tool that's available. And I would support what Paul said there in terms of the 20% reduction is ultimately a target that is going to be rolled out. It will focus the minds of local authorities in terms of how we're going to comply with that. And the range of activities we're going to have to do. I suppose one of the biggest tools in our army in terms of demand management is very much about how we deal with the network in terms of streets. And we've seen lots of examples in terms of the potential to reduce the impact around schools, for example. So Edinburgh's done some really good work in terms of that. We're now back into the discussion about the role of 20 mile an hour as a tool for influencing choice as to where and when you travel, how you travel. That's what essentially we would see demand management as. There's a big task, I think, for us to how you pull all those things together. So that is absolutely a joint thing. That's Scottish Government, the local authorities, the Regional Transport Partnerships, you know, the key transport bodies, how do you actually bring, make sure that they're, all of those different elements are working together. So, you know, that would be, I suppose, one of my asks would be to start to develop that in as collaborative a way as possible.
Can that 20% reduction target be met without some of these demand management measures, or are they, is some form of use of demand management going to have to be essential?
I think within city areas, in terms of that, that's, I think it's really going, you know, Bruxelles and COSLA work very positively with Transport Scotland on this one. So there are definitely places where you can achieve that, and with softer measures than some of the harder, potentially less popular ones. The bigger challenges are going to be, you know, for those areas where there are fewer alternatives, right, for that, actually making that switch. You know, so it may well be that the carrots will be more effective. So back to Paul's, you know, area of activity, you know, the role of the bus industry in being able to get people to change their travel habits and utilise the bus networks.
Okay, thanks. And Steve?
Specifically about the constraints on car use, I guess. There are two types, very, very broadly speaking. There would be the physical constraints, the reallocation of road space, but also to some extent the price you pay for parking, the things that are definitely within the ambit of the local authority, right through to, for example, a workplace parking levy, which would almost certainly be a local authority promoted thing, but with powers and undoubtedly with some help from the national Scottish government. And then there are the economic or fiscal measures, which would probably need to be something that was viewed as a national policy. On both of those fronts, I would say there are two things that are really quite important and that are sometimes missed in the transport debate when we get hostile transport experts like me yattering away and talking very knowledgeably, it seems sometimes. We rather miss, again, that bigger picture of why would I, as a Scottish citizen living in a place that's going to have these measures, think that implementing them is going to be better for me? I know that sounds rather selfish, but if we don't paint a picture of why a traffic calmed area, why an area with 20 mile an hour speed limits, where an area where street space has been reallocated to provide more space for cycling and walking and public transport, why is that better? Then it shouldn't surprise us that when measures are brought forward, we get something of the sort of backlash that Paul mentioned earlier on. And it's okay, there's a case for saying this is a tough political decision, but it's a decision we've taken. We're just going to bash ahead and people will get used to it. But wouldn't it be better if the argument was turned on its head, people were carried with us rather more? What we've seen with the implementation of some measures that certainly I'm familiar with in England and around Greater London is the more that the local community feels it's involved in deciding what the place people live in is going to be like and why they would like it to be different the way it is now, the smoother things go, whereas measures that are implemented quickly, many were during the COVID lockdowns, and then there was a sudden backlash of people saying, well, hang on a sec, I didn't like this, I don't remember anyone asking my opinion, and even if it turns out it's better for me, I draw the comparison with active travel. Active travel is undoubtedly better for all of us, but we don't necessarily all feel like doing it. So we need to be presenting why this is better in the future. The second point is, if we're going to use financial measures, we have to recognise that although people using cars, by and large, are wealthier than some of our households, nevertheless, low-income households are going to be the first that impacted. And quite often, those are households where people are doing low-income jobs, working what we used to think of as antisocial hours, and they're doing jobs that they have to go to. These aren't people who can work from home. You can't have office cleaners working from home. It just doesn't work. So we need to be thinking again, more broadly, if we're going to help those people, what's the complementary measure? If we're going to try to influence them not to use their own car or perhaps to car share or do something like that, what's the complementary measure that's going to help them financially over the hump, making the change? And that's not necessarily a complementary transport measure. that might be something in the social security system or in some other grant giving system that enables those people to make a change to their lifestyle.
Thanks. Very useful answers from all our panellists there. Can I move on actually and go back to Paul? And this is a question specifically about how councils could be and should be using the powers that are in the Transport Act that was passed in the last session of Parliament to support bus use. Where do you see the next tranche of activity that councils should be engaged in? And then I'll go back to Ewan on that as well, but if we take Paul first.
Certainly. Within the Transport Act, I don't know if you're referring to the powers around bus regulation or the powers around local emission zones, both within the Transport Act. I think we've seen progress in the local emission zones to date. We've got them in the four major cities that were due to be enforced in 2024. So I'll concentrate on the other measures. I think really what we have in the short term, as has been mentioned previously, we have a £500 million fund, the Bus Partnership Fund, which can be delivered where local authorities work with bus operators through bus service improvement partnerships to consider the means by which to improve matters for bus passengers. So part of that will be about reducing congestion, which I think is, but back to Steve's point around how do you market the benefits of demand management? And there's a virtuous circle, I think it appears within the National Transport Strategy for bus demand, where if you introduce those kind of measures and reduce congestion, you therefore make it cheaper to operate services. Therefore, you can see improvements in service in terms of frequency, running speeds, and fares reductions. So you get that positive loop. As people see that, and then more people travel by bus and ad infinitum. So I think you have that there that is in the short term the best, quickest means by which to deliver improvements for bus passengers. The Transport Act allows for authorities to consider whether or not they wish to consider a franchising scheme or a municipal operation. Both our options are on the table. I refer to recent research done by Sistra for the Strathclyde Partnership for Transport, which suggests these are things you consider. There are costs for both and there are timescales involved. And I think what we need to be careful about is that we don't jeopardise the short term, where we can deliver real improvements in the short term through that partnership model, holding back for longer term conversations, which we can have. But I would stress the need to make sure we really spend that £500 million well and quickly through the Bus Partnership Fund and partnership model.
Yeah, thanks. Ewan, any brief points to add to that?
It tends to be, so our seven regional transport partnerships who are part of Scots tend to be the ones who would lead for us around bus provision. I think the best way to sum that up would be we're currently considering all the options in terms of what are the costs and benefits of the powers that are being made available to us all in the Act. They are not insignificant in terms of the costs that would be involved in either going round a franchising or the municipal route. It's a long established model that we have in Scotland and the UK in terms of the bus side of things. The partnership model has worked well in lots of locations, but there are definitely still, I think everybody acknowledges, there are still gaps, at different parts of Scotland. And we see that emerging over the last 3, 4, 5 years. So I think we're probably in a position where we're just not, and colleagues in ATCO are all over this one, and the RTPs are looking at it carefully. What are our options here? And it is part of that. How does it fit in with demand management and changing the behaviours and giving greater choice in terms of the mode available?
Thanks very much. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Next up, we have Liam Kerr, and then Natalie Dawn will have the final questions. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'll direct my question to Steve Gooding because I'm going on something that you raised earlier, Steve, but I appreciate you and Wallace might want to come in. Steve, earlier on you flagged up commercial vehicles. You talked about vans and taxis and talked of them as enabling a town to function. Now, if we want to regenerate the high street, both generally and post-pandemic, logically, deliveries and commercial traffic is going to increase, especially in things like lorries. Now, Paul talked earlier about the business case for buses hinging upon the cost of the vehicle reducing, and presumably freight traffic is in exactly the same boat. So, in your view, what can a local authority do to reduce freight and commercial transport emissions whilst ensuring that there isn't an equivalent negative impact on the high street that some argue that the car park tax and a low emission zone would have?
Well, that is quite a tricky question. And again, I think we should just acknowledge it's a tricky one and there aren't any easy answers to that. So let me start with the fact that we are increasingly seeing different forms of vehicles that can be used for last mile deliveries. I'm thinking here of things like electrically boosted tricycles, electrically powered, quite small delivery vehicles. So it isn't necessarily the case that large vehicles need to be used all the time for replenishing the shelves of our city centre stores or indeed of our hospitality industry, the restaurants and hotels and the like. Nevertheless, there does need to be a recognition that if we're going to have city centre hotels, somebody's got to do the laundry. Somebody's got to make sure that the restaurant is stocked. Thinking about the times of day can be key. Thinking about where loading bays are provided for those commercial vehicles to stop is key. And then thinking about whether there is any scope for working with the commercial sector. I know that the committee has had evidence from and had a hearing with people in the commercial sector. Sometimes there are initiatives, I'm aware of, again, some in particularly down south, where retailers in a particular location have clubbed together and get a collective delivery of things they need rather than necessarily each of them having a van parked outside at the same time of day, taking up road space and holding up the traffic. Lastly, I think it is the case that although they've been slower to come forward because of the nature of battery design, principally, we are now seeing alternative fuels coming through into the commercial sector. The bigger, heavier vehicles, just as with buses, is harder. And maybe hydrogen is going to be the answer for the biggest vehicles. But we have seen in the last year, I think three, possibly four of the big auto companies bringing vans to market that are electric or at the very least hybrid. And I would say for local authorities in conversation with the Scottish Government, there's scope for thinking about clean air zones and the restrictions that apply to vehicles that are hybrid and capable of running on pure electric, so zero tailpipe basis, whether they should continue to be allowed in and not have to pay the clean air zone charges. I think it's important when thinking about clean air zones, I mentioned earlier about consistency. It can be quite confusing if you're a company that's delivering to multiple locations to find that one clean air zone has one set of rules and another has another. A bit more consistency might be the answer there. But also, it's likely that for many vehicles, the hybrid route is going to be easier for them, perhaps less expensive in terms of buying the vehicle as well. And therefore, if the vehicle can run on pure electric, then setting a threshold that it shouldn't be running on petrol within the confines of the city centre might be a better answer than simply saying, well, if that vehicle uses fossil fuels, then it's going to have to pay.
Thank you. Ewan Wallace, I'm going to come to you for my next question, but do you have anything to add to Steve Gooding's answer to my first question?
The only thing I would add, actually, is maybe build on that need to have that conversation both with national agencies, but also with essentially the freight operating companies within your individual city region areas that are impacted by low emission zones that are coming through the system at the moment. So you'll get a good feel for, and this is something that the Regional Transport Partnerships and some local authorities would do, go and talk to those operators. What are their plans in terms of changing out the type of vehicles that they currently operate? Many local authorities operate very large fleets themselves and are already looking at what the type of technology that Steve's just referred to. So is it going to be hydrogen? Is it going to I've also seen those transit size vehicles operating off very efficiently in terms of electric and hydrogen are already out there being trialled. So things could move quite quickly in terms of the available vehicle technology, but also then you'll get a feel for how the freight companies in your area actually operate, and you'll look as a local authority or a regional partnership to assist them as best you can, join up those companies so that they can try and operate as efficiently as possible.
I'm very grateful. Ewan, I'll stick with you for a second question, if you don't mind. You said earlier that you're based in the Northeast. Now, we talk a great deal, rightly, about getting people out of cars and onto public transport and or into electric vehicles with the charging infrastructure that we've heard about throughout today. In your view, though, is that really realistic in more rural areas of Aberdeenshire and similar local authority areas? And if not, what are the rural solutions that local authorities need to be exploring? For example, might local authorities like to see new rail lines being invested in and or the dualling of key roads to ensure a less polluting kind of stop-start and ensuring through traffic isn't going through town centres and clogging town centres for buses, like Paul is rightly concerned about?
So certainly, firstly, with my Scots hat on, in terms of there's good connections across all of the rural authorities in terms of sharing our experiences. I think what it goes back to is that something that potentially would allow towns within the borders to operate is often very, very similar to something that allows us to get better connectivity in transport terms for Aberdeenshire towns or for towns that are in the Highland, for example. And at the core of that is that's where local authorities have that ability to go and work with the community groups, talk to community councils, get feedback from their ward councillors about what the key core issues are. Getting that modal shift is reliant on being able to fund the level of bus services, for example. So I'll put my day job hat back on. So the use of demand responsive transport has been a very effective tool in the northeast of Scotland over a long period of time. It does cost that a little bit more, but it allows you to serve communities using bus services. And that in itself is developing across the UK now, where there's more, a more dynamic DRT services are being looked at. I know down in the London area, we have one running in Aberdeenshire, and we're looking carefully at how effective that is. So undoubtedly, that ability to utilise the bus network, it's still not as extensive as it probably needs to be in rural areas. And that's probably one of the big decisions for any rural authority is, would you rather invest in the revenue support for passenger transport that allows people to move about the area, whether that be for leisure activity, whether it be for business, whether it be for health and education. That's a decision point. Undoubtedly, the next element is also then the infrastructure that allows that to move more efficiently. And it may well be that there's going to be locations out with the central belt area of Scotland where some of the key routes will require investment. And those will be roads for the future. They will be built probably from different materials. They'll potentially have better telematics that allows information to be imparted. And that those roads then absolutely allow the electric vehicles, the hydrogen vehicles, to utilise them. We've already talked about earlier the ability to use interchange hubs. Your previous question related to freight. So it's joining all those different elements up so that you do have often integrated transport is seen as the interchange in the bus network, but it's all trips and all types of trips and all modes is actually the integration that we would typically try and develop as local authorities and regional partnerships. So all of those different elements, and some will need more than others, because there will be some sections of the overall network which are not at the standard they need to be. And so therefore, I think that will be part of a strategic approach, whether it be for the authority that I work for, or whether it be Highland, or whether it be Borders, or Dumfries and Galloway, Perth and Kinross, all those ones that have that ability where there's population spread across large areas, and it's about connectivity as much as it is the mobility of people as well. So that gives a sense of it's a really difficult question to answer in terms of just there's no one solution, and that's why you as MSPs will see a range of things coming forward at regional and local level that some people will support and others won't, but they're always done with that local dimension to them. So.
I'm very grateful. No further questions, convener.
Great, thanks very much, Liam. Let me bring in Natalie Dawn for the final questions. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to the panel. We've spoken this morning about local authorities' role in the delivery of a net zero transport system and equally the consistency across the board. But in relation to regional transport partnerships, what role does the panel feel that they can play in the delivery of net zero? And just following on from that, could I also ask if you feel that these roles might differ based on what model the RTP is? And whether any problems could arise from that based on different responsibilities or approaches or perhaps inconsistencies. And if I could come to you and Wallace, please, for that question first. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So we're fortunate in terms of, as a society, for a long time now, we've had all seven regional transport partnerships as part of our overall, I suppose, family within that local government family. And it's it's very, very positive in terms of how we work. I would absolutely see them being as key in terms of being able to look across boundaries, look at what the roles are of those different local authorities. I know they will have challenges sometimes, where there will be a different perspective in some of their partner authorities, and particularly for with colleagues at SBT, where they have a far larger range of powers, a much larger range of activities that they deliver. They are essentially the passenger transport authority for that area, and therefore they have to have good relationships with their local authorities. So that is quite different, but that means they have the ability to put in place a whole range of activities and bring forward lots of things. A lot of them we've talked about already this morning. Paul, in terms of CPT, they're heavily involved in working with the likes of SPT. You then have, I suppose, other authorities that are don't have quite so many direct powers, but they give that strategic overview and that ability for the partnership board to garner views from all of their partner local authorities and to be able to share across the boundaries. They now, of course, have the powers to retain funds beyond a single year in terms of capital funding. So that was part of what went in terms of the 2019 Transport Act. So that allows them to retain funding. So therefore they can look at things that are genuinely longer term and cross boundary. And I think I've made the point already, that is in many ways probably at the core of some of the delivery things we're going to have to do in relation to delivering on net zero. I don't necessarily see the models as being a constraint because they've been established since 2005, and those that are involved in working within those partnerships are well used to that. So I don't see them as a constraint as such. There is an existing piece of work under the auspices of the National Transport Strategy, of course, to look at the overall roles and responsibilities within Scottish Government And then local government, both in terms of regional transport partnerships and local authorities. So that is being looked at to see if there are better ways of tackling some of the issues, with net zero absolutely being one of the key things that group's looking at.
Okay. Thanks, Ewan. I'm not sure if Paul does have anything that you want to add to this. Otherwise, I have no further questions, Convener. Thank you.
Can do. I don't know if my mic's on. Yes, is my mic on? Yeah, okay. Thanks. I have to first of all declare an interest because I'm a non-councillor board member for SESTRANS in the southeast of Scotland. And I am one because I see a lot of value in the regional level. I think Ewan was probably hit the nail on the head when he said that strategic overview level. In terms of bus services, they don't fit neatly within the local authority boundaries. You'll have many that are longer distance, you'll have ones that cross over. And so there is an important role to have that strategic look at what's happening across a region and ensuring that the standards expected, be that emissions levels or the work going on to help improve bus services for a passenger, are all working together, have that holistic approach so that an authority isn't investing a lot of money in reducing congestion within their authority, but in the neighbouring authority, the bus is being held up 20 minutes for something else. So that kind of thing. I think you can see a real benefit of the work that SPT does as a Model 3 partnership in the Glasgow Bus Partnership. They play a good role on that. So yes, I'm a big advocate of the regional transport partnerships and the work they do.
Thanks, Paul. I'll hand back to the convener now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. We were running behind schedule slightly, but I did want to have one final question to Steve Gooding, because the concept of permitted development, I believe, is being used in parts of England to assist the rollout of charging points in supermarkets. And given this, the need to think creatively and have people charging the cars while they're spending 20, 30 minutes shopping, that seems to me to be one of the ways forward. I just wonder, Steve, how's that working in terms of using permitted development to expedite the rollout at supermarkets in England?
In all honesty, Convener, I'm afraid I don't know. I think it's an important option. I think that making it easier to enable the chargers to be fitted and having a conversation with the major supermarket chains to establish their enthusiasm or willingness to do that could be a key part of the future. And if I may, just very briefly, on the issue of regional transport authorities, we have touched on the issue of skills, knowledge and understanding. One of the things that the English Electric Vehicle Energy Task Force has picked up is that regional bodies could be the best place to develop that expertise, rather than expecting every single local authority to be recruiting people who understand all about electric chargers, how they work and where they might go. So there's a skills opportunity there as well.
Great. Well, as I said, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. Let me thank the panel once again for joining us this morning and for your very valuable insights. We covered a lot of ground and it's much appreciated. The committee will continue its scrutiny in relation to the local government inquiry in weeks to come. So thanks once again. Enjoy the rest of your day. The final agenda item this morning is consideration of a negative instrument, the Traffic Signs Amendment Scotland Regulations and General Directions 2022. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. Do any members have any comments on the instrument? There are no comments. I therefore invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Is that agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Thank you very much. I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you.